Welcome back to Health Matters. We're going to shift into brain health now. With thousands of baby boomers entering into late adulthood, the number of Alzheimer's patients is expected to drastically rise in the next few decades. With me to talk about the aging brain are neuropsychologists Dr. Diana Villacongia and Jane Story. Welcome, ladies.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for being here. So you own and operate a healthy aging clinic. I'm sure you see many conditions and profiles. Dementia, what can you give me an overview of dementia?
Yeah, as we're after the age of 30, as our brains start to sort of shrink and the extra cells start to die off, this continues to progress over time. But then what can also happen with that is we have the normal effects of aging. So, you know, our memories start to get lapse on us, our attention's not as good, or takes us longer to think. But then sometimes what can also happen is sort of pathological processes can develop over the course of aging. And basically what happens is then it starts to invade different parts of the brain, and therefore it really starts to impair and accelerate and create significant problems. Mm-hmm. So memory problems start to accelerate to a huge degree. People start showing poor judgment, alterations in behavior, and things like that. So we start to see a lot of pretty significant problems in just day-to-day, the ability to take care of themselves. So remembering how to organize their time, or remember what they're supposed to do through the day, things like that.
Mm-hmm. Other signs of dementia would be delusions, believing something is real that's contrary to the evidence, and hallucinating, incorrectly perceiving objects like bugs on a bed that aren't there. And I'm going to give you a little story. Close friends of mine who actually passed away, the husband, who's 90, had Alzheimer's, and the wife had dementia. She was in her 80s. And so it got to the point where when I went to go visit with them, the wife would look at me and say, "Lana, meet Pop." And I'd be like, "Who's Pop?" and Pop was her deceased father, who would have been well over 140 years old. But she started to see her husband as her deceased father. And no matter how many times I would try to explain to her that this man standing in front of her was actually her husband, she didn't believe me, right? She did not believe me. And so she would call the hospital and look for her husband, say, "Is my husband there? I don't know where he is." And she would get frustrated with them. And then she would look at her husband, who was her father, and say, "Don't worry, you know, Mac, her husband has a lot of money in the bank. We'll be fine. Don't worry about it."
Which brings up a good point. I mean, there are a lot of different types of dementias. And certainly Alzheimer's is the most common, and the one that everyone knows. Usually things like hallucinations and delusions are something that you don't really see until much later, and is not as common with Alzheimer's, but there certainly are other dementias where they affect sort of more frontal structures in the brain and so on, and you see a lot of these behavioral changes. You see a lot of hallucinations, delusions, believing things that, seeing things, perceiving things that don't actually exist. So they are certainly one of the types of dementias. That,
like the mail, I would show her the mail with her name on it and an address, and she'd be like, "Yeah, that's me, but I don't live there." Where do you live? Not there.
it might be interesting if we have time to talk about some more novel treatment approaches for people with Alzheimer's, because we do have this tendency to want to show somebody that, you know, that they're wrong, to let them know what the real information is, and to point out proper relationships that they're having with the people around them. But it causes them distress sometimes to do that, and it certainly causes frustration for the person who's trying to give those explanations. And some really amazing treatment facilities in Europe are being set up where a person is never corrected, so that whatever space they're living in, whatever's going on with them, the people around them, the people that work there, and their families who've been trained, just go with it.
Yeah, and that's what happened. It became going with the flow of where they're at in their process, because that's all you can do is support them in their process, and whatever they believe is what they believe.
Exactly. Right? Otherwise, it just causes tremendous distress.
Well, and that's what usually results in behavioral issues. So if you agitate somebody, if they become afraid or anxious or confused, it can manifest as behavioral outbursts, which people find very, very difficult to see and control. Mm-hmm. But if the person is calm, and they're just going through their day, they're not getting afraid, they're not getting confused, their lives are actually much more straightforward and a lot easier to deal with it.
Mm-hmm. And actually the Alzheimer's Society has put out some really good tips for people. so that, you know, they know how to interact. And, you know, people start to become afraid to have conversations with them because the conversations don't make sense and mm-hmm. so on. So they provide a lot of really good tips, you know, how to mm-hmm. pay attention, what kind of conversations to have, not correcting them, you know, sort mm-hmm. of how to speak to people so that, yeah. you know, they can, you can have, not a normal conversation, but certainly right. a reasonable conversation.
yeah.
And help them to try to at least be engaged in some way, because then otherwise they're off in their head, off in their thoughts, mm-hmm. and, you know, you're at least trying to you know, keep them interacting, which is really
sure.
important.
Now, he was diagnosed with Alzheimer's, and he would forget what would happen 2 minutes ago. So he was constantly saying to her, honey, you know, did I flush the toilet? Honey, did I shut the fridge door? Honey, did I do this? And this would just drive her up the wall. So then she called him, you know, he was either Repeat or he was Pop or he was Mac when she was calling the hospital trying to find him.
Mm. Yeah, and that's one of the hallmarks later on in Alzheimer's, is that basically there's no ability for the information that is in short-term memory, which is in the here and now, mm-hmm. to sort of go to long-term memory. So they're constantly just living in the moment. Mm-hmm. So when you test them, the memory patterns you can see is that there's no consolidation or transfer of that information to longer term memory stores. So everything that's happening is right here mm-hmm. and now.
And the research shows that these types of diseases burn through the brain at least 2 decades before they're actually diagnosed.
Well, mm-hmm. you know, what's very interesting though in this field is that a lot of people can have the pathology in their brain, and they've actually done a lot of autopsy studies with people who can be full of the pathology but functionally are doing fine. So this is where it's been very challenging to find the physical markers mm-hmm. or reliable physical markers of some of these dementias, because functionally there might be people who have less of the pathology in their brain mm-hmm. but functionally are really falling apart and mm-hmm. not doing well and showing a lot of the symptoms. So
how do you diagnose?
Basically, we do it through looking at sort of performance measures, so how mm-hmm. people are doing cognitively. So we look for the profiles in memory, attention, processing speed, judgment, so some of those executive functions that tend to be the hallmarks of different types of dementia, because it is the performance and what we also call the adaptive ability, so how they're functioning day to day. So there's a number of different indicators you look at to see if people are fitting that profile, because mm-hmm. there's normal aging, and that's what's becoming very confusing for people. What's normal aging and what now becomes something that's pathological? So it's helping people to understand what's normal versus when it becomes mm-hmm. very accelerated and problematic.
And you really can't diagnose Alzheimer's for certainty.
Welcome back to Health Matters. I'm discussing the aging brain with neuropsychologist Dr. Diana Valcanja and Dr. Jane Story. Dr. Jane, sorry to cut you off.
I was just saying that because we can't diagnose Alzheimer's mm-hmm. Prior to autopsy, what we do is we render a diagnosis of DAT, or diagnosis of the Alzheimer's type. Mm-hmm. But there are some kinds of dementia that do show up on neuroimaging. So for example, a more frontal dementia, you can see shrinkage or atrophy of the brain mm-hmm. in particular areas. And so you can do a more definitive diagnosis without having to wait till autopsy.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Okay, going back to this couple that I've been talking about, so whenever they would go to see their medical doctor, the first thing the medical doctor would do is give them the mini cog test, mm-hmm. right? So it's a self-assessment that really anybody could do at home, and if there's an issue, they could come and see you ladies, probably to see if there's something, a mild cognitive impairment. But the mini cog test is for people to know at home, is to remember and recall at least three common household words, like car key, table, and bed, right? So car key table in bed.
I'm being tested.
You're being tested. And then the second part of the test is to draw a clock in the time, mm-hmm. Like let's say 4 o'clock, and oftentimes people with a cognitive impairment will draw a lopsided clock, or the numbers will be backwards. Mm-hmm.
They'll have some perceptual difficulties. Yeah. So certain types of dementias, you'll see these kinds of difficulties. So mm-hmm. they can't perceive things that they see in the proportion dimension that they should be, right? So that's why the tests are made up to tap into some of these things. So mm-hmm. memory being the most common, the perceptual difficulties, just being able to name things, being able to generate words are important too.
Where does mild cognitive impairment fit on the spectrum?
Mild cognitive impairment is a state where you have normal aging, mild cognitive impairment, and mild cognitive impairment can then just continue and never become anything that's significantly pathological or dementia-like, or there's a significant percentage that can go stay that way, or quite a percentage that can then go on to become something more pathological, a type of dementia. So that's why mild cognitive impairment is kind of that pivotal point.
Mm-hmm. So what type of battery of tests do you do, or what type of screening?
So generally when people are more affected, you're looking at things, again, like we talked about, you're looking at memory, you're looking at attention, the mm-hmm. ability to generate words, the ability, you're looking at judgment, you're looking mm-hmm. at reasoning abilities, you're looking at perceptual skills, things like that, and you're comparing their scores to that of their peers, so people who are the same age, generally in background, trying to get an idea of how different this mm-hmm. is from what normal aging sure. or what normal processes. And again, that adaptive functioning, like I talked about how they're doing day to day, so how they're functioning in their normal lives.
And I'm sure families are very grateful too, because doing that screening gives them the information they need to assess their home and see, okay, what type of home care do we need at the home based on this screening, because research does show that people put in nursing homes are more likely to get an infectious disease such as influenza or even staph infection, just because congenital living places people in close proximity, their immune systems are compromised, and the people going there already have a chronic disease.
And the idea is to try to help people age in place, which is the sort of, being able to stay at home. Well, that's
the idea of aging in place is that we're keeping people functional enough that they can stay in their own homes as long as possible. So as long as medically safe to do so. And why that's important for us here in Ontario, of course, is we already have quite a waiting list for assisted living beds, mm-hmm. And that problem is going to get worse. The boomers, and having just turned 50 on Sunday, I'm the last of the boomers, so the babies of the boomers are now 50. And so we're starting to see that what some people have called the silver tsunami, although I'm not sure we all appreciate that term. But we're going to have more and more people requiring nursing home and assisted living beds, and there aren't going to be enough for everyone. And so if we can help someone stay home by determining what their strengths and weaknesses are, mm-hmm. to determine whether or not they're having a dementing process going on or it's just normal aging, if there is an issue, to make sure that they have the right supports in place, mm-hmm. so whether it's physiotherapy or occupational therapy or a rehab support worker, we can make sure that a person can be very, very safe within their own home. And that is so good for people's psychological status,
sure.
to be able to stay at home, mm-hmm. and to be as independent as possible. And so it really is a worthwhile goal, I think. And that was one of the reasons why we wanted to do a healthy aging clinic.
Mm-hmm. And even for people who, as we are aging, just to provide people with information about the kinds of things you can do so that, all these small changes in cognitive ability pose less of a problem mm-hmm. every day. So, just the kind of little tips mm-hmm. to sort of not make that decline in memory and other things like that create such a problem day to day.
What is, you hear a lot about elder mediation.
Yeah, so elder mediation is something that's very popular in the United States right now. Mm-hmm. And I think people are familiar with the concept of mediation in other areas, and certainly in divorces, more and more people are choosing mediation as an option. Elder mediation comes into play when really big decisions need to be made. So estate planning, or whether or not someone's elderly parents need to go into nursing home or not. These decisions can cause an awful lot of stress on a family.
So, a couple seconds left.
So, you come and see someone we offer elder mediation, and what we do is we start a dialogue and communication between members of the family so that everyone can make the same decisions and be happy with them.
Nice. Ladies, thank you so much for being here. Definitely come back. I mean, we just touched upon a little bit. And happy birthday to you.
Thank you.
You don't look a day over 50.
Thank you.
That's great. Any last minute tips for people who do have Alzheimer's, what they should do? Come see you, get screened.
Come see us, get screened.
Avoid doing self-assessments, because it's just going to make you nervous. Come talk to a professional.
Come see the expert. Come see the expert.
Yes.
Maybe I need to come see you.
Yeah.
Do you remember those three words I asked you? I don't. All right. Thanks for tuning in to Health Matters tonight. Have a wonderful evening. Thank you.